You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Missy, and I am sitting at the table with two of my favorite friends, Beth and Gwen. Welcome back to the table, ladies.
It's so good to be here.
It is. It's so refreshing. It just invigorates. I walk out just feeling like I just got plugged into a charger.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Charged up, fed. Yeah. Just a chance to sit, to be still, to look at the Word of God. I mean, time to pray together. And, you know, when we leave this place, we are doing life with a whole different perspective, because we've been reminded of whose we are and why we do what we do. Absolutely. So, you know, seasons come and seasons go. Tell me, are there things that were a big part of your life? Let's say, think back 20 years. What was I 20 years ago? How many kids ago was that?
20 years ago, I don't know.
Where were you 20 years ago?
2000, basically. Mm. In the year 2000.
Yeah, that would be right. So what were you doing in the at the turn of this century?
World.
Wow. Turn of the century. What were you doing? Were you working in the same place?
Nope.
Were you living in the same state?
Same state, not the same house.
I was exiting Ohio.
Okay.
I was going on my biggest adventure.
Okay. Tell me more.
Well, in 2000, I graduated college from Ashland, and I joined Edge Corps. And I told them I'd go anywhere, and they sent me to Knoxville.
Okay.
So it was the beginning of living away from home and growing up. And those 2 years that followed were probably the biggest growth spiritually in my entire life. Honestly, the best decision I ever made.
So this is when you got connected with the Navigators.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's 20 years ago.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting that I think as my children have grown now and we're kind of past that point of I'm long past empty nest. You know, we have 11 grandkids. All our kids are parenting in those years. But watching them through the course of that, I remember there was and Beth, maybe you'll resonate with this, there was a real concern about where they would go to school, being on their own, all these things. And I remember my oldest son in particular, I had his college picked out because it was a wonderful Christian school. I felt, you know, all these things that I thought were going to be, you know. And he didn't want to go there, and he didn't go there. Mm-hmm. He chose his own way, but he grew so much. And, you know, it was during that time period where I was like, all right, okay, Lord, you're right, you're right, you've got this. Mm-hmm. I don't have to have so much control. You know, you think you need control, but really, God takes them on their own journey, and they have to have their own journey of faith. And I always believe that. But that was the hard part of letting go for me, was like saying, okay, I'm the mom and I'll be here, but it looks like a whole different kind of mothering, parenting kind of thing at that point. So, and you've got to let them fall and fail.
Yeah. So God didn't need your advice.
He didn't. And there were things that happened at school that I was not particularly happy with, but that's okay. He fell. God helped him get back up. He learned through the process. And I think that's true with all of my kids. You know, some of the things that they went through that were really difficult for them to go through, they didn't need mama. You know, they needed their own faith and trust in the Lord. And as parents, that's really what we need to shoot for, that when you send them out, you know, they mostly need our prayer, a lot of prayer, more prayer, and continue to pray. Mm-hmm. But just kind of letting go of that, because at that point I'd given them all my opinions.
Really, they knew exactly what mama thought about everything.
They took you along to college, whether you were still living back home or not.
Mom in my head screamed.
You're welcome.
It was so hard to get her voice to quiet down. She has no idea how loud she was. Anyway,
Well, I'm not afraid to say things at this point in their life, but I use those, what I call my parenting prerogatives, very sparingly, you know, especially as a grandparent. My kids are wonderful parents. I look at them and I think, wow, if I had known that or done that, I wonder, you know, obviously we all have our strengths and our weaknesses, and we look back and think that, oh, if we just done this or done that.
Right.
I mean, we can beat ourselves up one hill and down another for a lot of things in our life. But it's exciting to me to see them not just they're not just like me, and that is okay. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. I think sometimes as parents, mm-hmm. we think, oh, we've got to reproduce ourselves. No, no, we want them to be in their full, fully bloomed as God has created them and made them. And sometimes it looks way different than what we kind of started out trying to grow them,
mold them into. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So yeah. You have to recognize that He made them in His image, yes. not in yours.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's a little
yeah.
tough yeah. for some of us sometimes, but.
Yeah. As I was listening to you talk, Missy, I was just hearing how parenting changes over the developmental stages yeah. of your children. You know, that it shouldn't look like it does at four.
No. Right.
When they're 19. It right. should look very different. Right. Like, it should look like Mama has released hold.
Yeah.
And, you know, she's still there maybe with a safety net yeah. to some extent, but by and large, they're on the trapeze yeah. alone.
And it's a progressive yeah. thing, so that when yeah. they hit their teen years,
they're
you
ready.
Are allowing them to make some decisions. Even yeah. at that point, we were allowing them to make some decisions that was kind of hard to let go of because mm-hmm. I wanted to say, no, you can't. And there were a few things that we said, no, that's yeah. not going to happen. And my daughter probably still holds some of those things against me. Maybe not now. She has a couple daughters of her own.
I was going to say, she'll understand think, someday if she
no,
doesn't yet.
She, I think. But at the same time, allowing them to make decisions and then the consequences that came with that, yeah. you know, under the safety and the umbrella of your household,
yeah.
allowing them to take those first steps of independence,
yeah.
That's hard because mm-hmm. there's some hard mm-hmm. lessons. Beth, you know that well, and Gwen, it's yeah. ahead of you, but you'll see mm-hmm. the same kinds mm-hmm. of things.
Well, I walked it.
Yes.
You know, and the biggest thing I've learned with counseling is that that rebellion stage is normal.
Yeah.
Because they're getting ready to rule their own.
Yeah.
And so they have to fight against parental authority.
Yes.
Because they have to flex their muscles
yes.
enough to be able to manage their own domain. If you have a kid who's gone through teenagehood and has not earned their own voice and started using it and making their own decisions and pushing back from you, you've got a kid that's enmeshed with you and they need to rebel against you at some point.
See, it's really interesting that you say that because I remember talking to a young lady at camp. She actually was my niece and she was so, her personality, I mean, she was the quote unquote perfect child. Mm-hmm. You know, she was just very, I adored her. Wonderful. Mm. And she never gave her parents any trouble ever. And she never voiced her own opinion.
Yeah.
In a family where we're all opinionated, mm-hmm. I could see that that would be a struggle if that's mm-hmm. your personality. And I yeah. remember talking to her after a chapel service one day and I said, Jen, this is going to sound really odd coming from, you know, your aunt, but you need to rebel.
Yeah.
And she just kind of looked at me. I said, I'm serious. You need to find your own voice. Yeah. And if it's contrary to what Mom and Dad are saying, or even Uncle Ned and Aunt Missy, you need to voice it anyway.
Yeah.
And it was like she needed permission to do that in some ways. Mm-hmm. But if we're not careful, I mean, rebellion's going to come yeah. at some point, right? I mean, yeah. I kind of feel that way. I don't know, Gwen, if that's true or not, but I feel like
all of us
have
absolutely.
To
absolutely. It has to.
We break away at some point. Mm-hmm. So better to do it under the household of a mom and dad mm-hmm. that are ready for that, prepared for that.
Yes.
Able to help them pick up the pieces and move forward and rebel in ways that are not catastrophic. Does that make sense?
If we don't break away, then that is, I believe the counseling term is...
Enmeshment.
Enmeshment or codependency.
Yes, codependency too. They can kind of be the same thing. Basically, what it means is that you don't have good boundaries. You don't have a place where you stop and the other person mm-hmm, starts. Mm-hmm. That other person is just all through you. Mm-hmm. And so you can't find yourself. You're invisible. Mm-hmm. And so you'll walk into another relationship and you'll be invisible. Mm-hmm. And it's really hard to be in relationship with somebody who's invisible mm-hmm. because they don't want anything. They don't hate anything. They don't like anything. They're just kind of always agreeing with you. And so they don't know their own selves.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a person that has no boundaries of their own. And so they will sop up and absorb other people's emotions, their conflicts, their struggles, and they will live for other people more than they will ever live for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
In that unhealthy state.
The unhealthiness of that is that we're called to give and sacrifice ourselves, but how are you sacrificing if you don't know what you're sacrificing? Do you know
right.
what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the unhealthiness of it is they don't know who they are.
Exactly.
and they they're
don't
not,
know what belongs to them,
right? So they don't know what they're giving to someone right. else, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and they're actually it's almost being taken away from them on, yeah. on occasion. I'm sure in the worst case situations.
Changes That Heal by Cloudon Townsend is the book I send people to first for separating from parents and becoming your own person, because it explains how you bonded in childhood with authority figures, with your parents, with, you know, it reflects how you see God, yourself, and others as an adult. And then it talks about how to grow up and become an adult. Mm-hmm. And it hits all of this, Missy. It hits what it looks like when you have no boundaries. It hits how you see authority if you've never defined who you are. You know, all of those kinds of things that kind of flow out of this. The biggest problem with having no personal boundaries and absorbing other people's stuff is that you cannot control other people's domains. Mm-hmm. You can't control their emotions. You can't control their drama. You can't control, you know, what they do with things. And so you are absorbing and taking responsibility for all of these things you can't control.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so you're a wreck, mm-hmm. and you're trying to control things that aren't yours.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And there's no end to you.
Mm. You recommend
and the weight of that is horrific.
Yeah. Again, it's a weight you were never meant to carry.
Yes, yes. Right. Yeah, exactly.
You
yes.
recommended that book several years ago, yeah. and I got it immediately, and I've read through it yeah. multiple times, and I bought the second copy, and and we've done it at Radical Mentoring. Yeah. But the most beautiful story I love from this book, so I'm so thankful when you recommend books, is that a year or so ago, it was kind of a random meeting of someone. Met her at a banquet, and then we ended up in the same line at the grocery store
a month
or so later. And she said, "Do you ever like go to lunch with people?" And I'm, "Oh yeah, that's kind of what I do." And
that's awesome.
Just in sitting and talking mm-hmm. with her, when we were done talking that day, I said, "You know, I don't want to be a crazy book lady, but the stuff you've told me, there's a book that I think you would really benefit from, Changes That Heal by Cloudon Townsend." And I recommended it. She got it. And I said, "Give me a call when you get to chapter 4 or 5. And well, you know, if you want to talk about it, we can." Well, we did. She said, "I hate this book. It's like a mirror of me."
Yeah, exactly.
I said, "Yep.
Everybody finds themselves in this book.
It's not an easy book, but it's a good book."
Yeah.
Well, recently she sent me a text, and it was a picture of the end of a book, and she said, "You know what this is?" And I said, "The end. Are uh-huh. you going to burn it now?" And she said, "No, actually, I bought a copy for a friend, mm-hmm. and she's going to need me to walk through this."
Yeah, it took me 2 years to get
right.
through it, and by the end of it, I was completely different.
Right.
I couldn't read it faster because I was fixing things in my life in pace with the book.
It's a pretty great book. Changes That Heal awesome. By Dr. Henry Cloud and John Townsend. And you know what? We need to take a little break, and we'll come back and talk a little more. Thanks for joining us at the table.
Village Gift Barn in Berlin, Ohio carries one-of-a-kind finds, just as unique as you. Our elegant shop has everything you need to dress up your home and your wardrobe. We're dedicated to offering new, exciting merchandise. As you explore our 3 amazing floors, that's over 20,000 square feet, you'll discover everything from home decor and furnishings to a beautifully diverse women's boutique. Are your walls blank? Is your furniture blah? Do you never have anything to wear? We've got you covered. Stop by and let our friendly, knowledgeable team help you create a look that's all your own. Village Gift Barn is located in the heart of Amish country at 4755 State Route 39 in Berlin, Ohio.
Are you and your work team in need of a few hours out of your everyday operations to connect, communicate, and collaborate to set goals for 2020? The Vision 2020 Small Business Workshop at Amish Door Village in Wilmot could be your answer. Right in the heart of Amish country, Amish Door provides the setting for our productive, interactive, and fun team-building opportunity from 8:30 until 12:30 on March 10th. The theme is execution, and our facilitators, Gail Kreitz, Kevin Billy, and Marlon Miller, will give your team tools and time to take their execution skills to the next level to accomplish the goals you set during the workshop. Just $57 per teammate. For more information, check it out on Facebook, Vision 2020, Small Business Conference, or call Kevin Billy at 330-418-0313 at Plain Values in Winesburg, Ohio. Execute your plan now and register for the Vision 2020 mini retreat for your team. That's Vision 2020 Small Business Conference. You can find it on Facebook or call Kevin at 330-418-0313.
Found a place to belong here in the Circle Friends. Everybody, welcome back to the table. Beth, I love you. I love spending time with you. It's like finding a soul sister, you know?
It's a
seriously, you
to
and
sit
Missy,
at this table.
Soul sisters. That's my term for people that your soul just exhales with and you just see eye to eye. Mm-hmm. Love sitting here with you guys. Mm-hmm. I love your story about this book because what you're finding that woman experienced with Changes That Heal is something that I see over and over again with Changes That Heal as a book. I recommend it before Boundaries, actually. And it's the same authors.
Correct.
But I think it explains why we need Boundaries better than the Boundaries book does because it puts the context in play.
Well, I believe that it was written before Boundaries, correct?
I'm not sure.
I think that it was written and then they were asked to write the book on Boundaries. A book on
probably
boundaries.
From that.
So it's excellent. Yeah. In fact, I have an opportunity to do a breakout session at a conference in Virginia here soon. And when they asked me to do it, originally they said, Beth, we want a list of all the books you've ever read. Mm. Okay. And it was about a year ago they asked me. So I'm like, oh, I can try
ever
to do that.
Read?
Ever read. Well, once I started reading books that were actually edifying, okay, because
gotcha.
That wasn't always my world. But when I went to start doing that several months ago, I just really felt God speak to my heart, and I was in total agreement. I don't want to give a list of books to the ladies who come to this session and have them leave looking for a bunch of books to read.
Mm.
I want them to leave wanting to read the Word of God.
Exactly.
So I'm not giving them a list of all the books I've read. But I decided to do a fun little thing of if I was packing up and moving south, wouldn't that be lovely where it's warm all the time and sunshine and sand? But if I was packing up my household where I truly abide, what books or dwell, you know, I dwell in this house. It's very me. It has a lot of books there. What books would I take? Because you can't take them all.
Right.
So I'm giving a list of five, and Changes That Heal is one of the books on it.
Can we ask what the others are?
Yes, you can. The very first one, of course, is my Bible. Now, there might be five Bibles that get packed up.
Love that.
Yeah. So, but the Bible, Victory Over the Darkness by Neil Anderson. Mm-hmm.
That's a good one.
It covers identity, and it covers the spiritual warfare that happens in our lives when... You know, when we're Christ followers, there's a target on our back. So I love that one, Changes That Heal. And then this one's maybe a little different, but it's because with the women that I meet with, one thing that I glean from multiple conversations is that they're praying for a lot of people, but they forget to pray for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So I really like Stormy O'Martian's Power of a Praying Woman. For several reasons.
Love
she
Stormy.
Brings it right back to us. She is so word-based. Mm-hmm. I mean, her the chapters are filled with the word, the prayers at the end of each chapter are filled with the word, and then she has scriptures that you can memorize and hide in your heart at the end. So, and the fifth one is just a fun one. My kids will laugh when they see my list because they know I've read this book about 20 times. It's a novel. It is a romantic novel written by Laurie Wick. It's called Sophie's Heart.
I love Sophie's Heart.
Yes, it's such a sweet read. And I realize not everyone is looking to read something that is deep. And these other books can get, well, especially, so the Bible you need to read with the author by your side so that he can help you know in that, as Priscilla Shire says, know in your knower what it is speaking to you. And so is Victory Over the Darkness and Changes That Heal. Like you said, it took you 2 years to read through it. The Power of a Praying Woman, that to me, it's a 30 or 31 chapter book. So you could do it in a month, but it's one of those you should be doing every day. You should be praying for yourself every day. But Sophie's Heart is just a gentle read. And I pull it out about once a year. My girls have read it. It's just a sweet reminder of... Well, Laurie Wick just did a really good job of modeling a woman's heart that really wants to honor God in all that she does. So if you haven't read it, you should.
It's been a while.
It's been a while. And if it's been a while, you should read it again. Especially now that you have kids. Because if you didn't read it when you had kids, your whole perspective will change now as you read it. But those are my, if I was packing up and moving south, those are my five titles.
Five books you take with
you. Yeah, five titles.
I have, I've read all of them, and I have three of them on my Kindle.
Well, and that's not to say I don't love other books. I mean, I've been talking about Andy Stanley's book, Louder Than Words, this week. That's a book I've used every year in Radical Mentoring because I think it's so wonderful. There are books... Oh, I like The Cure. I've talked about that one by Bill Thrall and...
Thrall and Bruce McNichol?
Yes, yes.
Love them.
Yes.
They are worth the read.
Right. Well, The Cure is very easy. It's a 7-chapter book. Chapter 5 is on forgiveness. Wow, yowza, wow.
They talk about the grace versus living in... or don't want it?
Yep. It's,
you know,
so
it.
Each chapter is about two somethings. Two roads is you get to choose this path. Are you going to live in the room of grace, trusting God, or are you going to live in the room of good intentions, which is pleasing God? And then I don't have the book in front of me, but I know there's two faces. You know, you can show your real, authentic, genuine face. Or you can wear a mask.
Fine.
Yes, I'm fine. Oh, my. The third one, maybe Two Gods, because we tend to see God. I love this. I watched a YouTube video of, I don't know if it was Bill Thrall or...
Bruce McNichol?
John... I need to find that name so that I can give that to you. But he said, it's almost as if we see God as a supersized Santa who is saying to us, you better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why I'm coming to town. And he said, that's not who God is, but that's who we make him to be. We are to fear God, but that's not the kind of fear we're supposed to have of God. So there are two gods, the one who is the true God and the one that we have maybe made according to what we've been taught or our experience or the culture around us. So that would be chapter 4. Chapter 5 is two healings. Oh, my. All about forgiveness. So beautiful.
Well, I'm familiar with him because a couple of years ago, I had a friend from the NAVS. He must have spoken at a conference for them, and he sent me their CD.
Okay.
And it was Bill Thrall or Bruce McNichol, but it was him saying everything you just said. And I'm telling you, it is the most powerful CD I've ever listened to in my life. I actually have listened to it so much it's scratched, and I need to find a better copy.
I would love to have that.
That
CD is one that I would keep in my car and play all the time. But like I said, it is excellent as far as just reading the book, reminding yourself, again, I'm on my third or fourth read of this book because of radical mentoring. Mm. But each time I just get more and more from it. So it's an excellent read. It's not on my top five because you can only pack so many books and move mm-hmm. south, right?
Yes.
And I'm not moving south. So fortunately, I don't have to make the cut. But there are so many other wonderful books, too, that, you know, I do love books. But go to the Word first.
What's that book called again?
The Cure. And again, you said Bill McNichols, Bill Thrall.
And Bruce McNichols.
Bruce McNichols. I'm going to give it to you right now because you need to know all three authors. John Lynch, Bruce McNichol, and Bill Thrall. So, excellent book, short read, an allegory. So it's written in a little different style. You'll have the story, and then you'll have the author jump back in and explain it from more of the theology. And interestingly enough, the author that's on the YouTube video, he was raised a Mensa atheist. Mm-hmm. His dad is still an atheist, but he went to college, became a teacher, and his students led him to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful, just simply and beautiful.
For most people who don't know, Mensa is high intelligence.
Right.
So it's a very academic echelon, higher echelon.
Right.
So, yeah.
Right. But as I said, there are other wonderful books that I'm glad I don't have to get rid of just yet. And maybe, just maybe, my husband will rent that U-Haul just for my books.
Just for your books.
When the day comes that we are going to.
I love my library.
Books are, I love the paper. I love the paper and ink, and I love underlining and highlighting and writing notes in the margins. And I know some people just cringe mm-hmm. to hear that, but they are a comfort to me. Again, just wonderful books out there. Many great authors. I know some great authors that I didn't mention mm-hmm. their books. That doesn't make them not mm-hmm. not great books. It's just my, if I was packing up a moving list that I had to... bring it down to, there's another one on identity that's actually such a small read that I could probably stick it in the box of five and no one would see it and I'd still have it. And that was written by a man from the Navigators called, now I'm going to lose his name right now, but the book is Who Am I?
Jerry Bridges.
Jerry Bridges, yes. Excellent book on identity. I've had women in radical mentoring say this answered so many questions for me. So there are great books out there. Go to your Christian bookstore and maybe you're familiar with some of the authors, maybe you're not, but wonderful books out there. And when they are written from the foundation of the Word of God,
absolutely,
you can trust what's in them.
Yes.
So again, keep your Bible handy. Because it is up to you to look to the Word and make sure that it is being written and taught in a manner. Whether you're going to church or reading a book, it comes back to we have to have this plumb line, this foundation of truth that we know as the Bible and it is the Word of God. So I've talked about my books. What about yours?
Hmm.
Is there one that you would throw out there quick? Because I know we have a listener that's saying, I need that book. You know, there's one. Oh, this is kind of a dangerous one. It's a little older. 3 years old, maybe. Fierce Women by Kimberly Wagner. I should bring that one in again because at the back of that book, I love the index where it talks about a beautifully fierce woman and a destructively fierce woman. That speaks to my heart as wife and mother. Really good read. And I think her husband wrote the counterpart to that book called Men Who Are Married to Fierce Women. Ha 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 ha. It's true.
Love it.
Well, ladies, we are at the end of our day. We started out by saying, what were you doing back in 2000? I think it's probably very accurate to say we were all reading.
Yes.
And that has not changed. Life has changed. God is faithful. He is also unchanging. And so that's why we do what we do. We point you back to the truth of His Word, and we remind each other and each of you, listener, He is faithful. And if we will just commit our plans to Him, trust in Him with all of our hearts and not lean on our own understanding, He will direct this path that we're walking here on this planet Earth in this thing called life. We're so glad you've joined us here at the table. You have found a place to belong. This program was brought to you through the generous support of donors and listeners like you. To contact Circle of Friends Ministries, you can write to P.O. Box 345, Berlin, Ohio, 44610, or find us on Facebook at circleoffriends.fm. Program archives can be found at thelight959.com.